your eyes.
What's wrong with my eyes?
Well, they're red. Bloodshot.
You ought to see them from my side. Constant breeding ground for dashing men who have left audiences limp with their image and adventurous escapades on the giant screen. Heroes the likes of Errol Flynn, Tyrone Power, Clark Gable, Rudolph Valentino were gods to their ardent movie fans, and they could do no wrong. But today a new breed of man has exploded on the motion picture horizon, and one of these is Lee Marvin. He demands and gets $1 million for each movie role he portrays. He holds his audiences with agonizing impact and has literally smashed his way to the top of cinematic stardom. His screen adventures are fast becoming a legend in a town that has had its share. But there are those who say no screen role he has played can match the one role he loves the most, his adventures in real life. We'll explore those adventures as we paint this portrait. Lee Marvin. Sounds pretty good, huh?
Yeah.
We're on location in Baker, Oregon, during the filming of Paramount's multi-million dollar musical, Paint Your Wagon. For Lee Marvin, this represents a complete departure. In Paint Your Wagon, he will also sing.
Who's the man who's directing?
Elliot Daniels, he's the assistant.
Have you studied singing at all?
No, never, Joe. I'm actually...
Well, how about here? Did you have to take lessons?
No, Alan J. Lerner and Josh Logan felt it might be better. It was just kind of the natural sound that a guy in my position would make.
Mm-hmm.
And also, he told me when I got shaky of the knees not to worry, because he knows how to write for actors, and he certainly does, because the stuff is very easy to do.
Mm-hmm. Do you talk? Or?
No, it's a semi-age. I sing and shout it, because it's a reprimand, you know? Thing called the first thing you know, God made the mountains, God made the sky, God made people, God knows why. Because I'm more like a mountain man.
But that's kind of you also, in a way, isn't it?
Yeah, by myself.
This is sort of the ideal part for you.
So far it has been. I don't see any reason for it not to be.
Well, the character in Cat Ballou, for example, is he the father to this or the son to this?
Well, he'd be my son.
He'd be the son to this.
Right.
Yeah?
Because, the character I play, Ben Runson, is even a bit wilder than Kid Chalene.
The last time I come for Tombstone, the big excitement there was about the new roller skating rink that they laid out over the OK Corral. I'll tell you something else. I used to work the Buffalo Bill Wild West show in the Congress of the Rough Riders, and I rescued many a stagecoach passenger from road agents and drunken engines in the nick of time. Twice a day, three times on Saturday.
Kind of a location for an outdoor fellow like you.
Well, you're sensational. I just eat it up every day.
Well, when you're on a spot like this, I would think the yearning would be to get off and fish a little and do a little hunting on your own. Have you had a chance for that yet?
No, not at all. We're working 6 days a week, and so on the seventh day, I usually take easy. But really, the picture is of such magnitude that hunting and fishing don't enter my mind. because it's such a thrill doing this, you know, in a sense, because you've seen assassins, how wild they are.
You really get that deeply into a role that you look forward to it and get up in the morning and you're excited about going to work?
Yeah. Plus, what's happening with this type of role in the last one I finished is that I found it's just like, work is just to stay with it.
Mm-hmm.
Don't relax one day. Once you relax, you might lose it. So you just get it done.
I mean, you stay in the character in that sense.
Yeah.
Yeah,
which is kind of tough on my friends, I guess. But...
Hey, guys!
When you have time that's your own, just for you, what are the things that you most like to do? Do you like to get on a bike and take off? Do you like to sail fishing, get on a boat?
I used to do all of those things. I used to ride bikes very avidly.
A long time ago, we rode together.
Yeah, the big bear run. That's just something else. But I know, I kind of got over bikes about, I'd say, maybe 6-7 years ago.
Why?
I think primarily because I became more interested in my work. My work took up more of my thinking time, whereas when I rode bikes, it was more or less an escape from work.
Right.
But now I still like to go marlin fishing and sail fishing.
Well, I remember that big bear one.
Yeah, the big bear. I made 3 of those.
Including Lee Marvin, take off in pursuit of the hare. It's 156 miles of rugged desert terrain to the finish line in Big Bear, California. That Lee enters is the Catalina Grand Prix. This time it's Catalina Island, 28 miles off the Southern California coast. Again, Keenan Wynn, number 118, and Marvin, number 119, rode some 200 riders. It's 10 times around the 10-mile course, and it all starts in downtown Avalon.
would say that Lee got up to the first three on the West Coast riders. The first three. He would always be second, third, fourth. But all of a sudden he quit. And I know why he quit. Because he wasn't number one. And Lee will only stay with something if he's number one. And the only reason it happened with the motorcycles, of course, is because he started riding motorcycles at, say, 35, which is a little late to start in competition.
I never busted my head.
How did you start with a bike?
When I was doing the wild one. You know, remember Sam Farrell from a brand up.
As far as motorcycles are concerned, I got really interested in that and started them really on it. And originally I was supposed to be in the Wild Ones, the movie that Bud Brando did. But I was under contract to MGM at that time, and they wanted too much money for me, so they got a guy named Lee Marvin.
And fishing, I seem to want you in Mazatlan for a while?
Yeah, I fished a lot in Mexico. In fact, Rick Spallo, one of your producers, we went down there years ago to do a thing on sailfish, and he allocated 3 days to get the footage you needed. We lucked out, we got 7 to 4 noon on the first day, so we had to pack up and go home.
Executive, and Courtney Marvin, a beauty expert and fashion magazine editor. He attended numerous schools, including St. Leo's Benedictine in Dade, Florida. His fascination for outdoor life has included hunting, fishing, riding bikes, and more recently, a strong love for boats.
You're having a boat made for yourself now, aren't you?
Yeah, now in the Southwest Pacific, down in Palau, which is in the Trust Territories. I'm going to leave it there. It only takes you 23 hours to fly there, but when you go down, you go down for a couple of months and just fish yourself out. It's beautiful. It is. I went down to Palau and went through all the caves and stuff and up at Saipan where I got hit.
Yeah.
And no heart strings, no...
Nothing. No ghosts?
No ghosts at all. All bones, yes, skulls, all over the joint. But no regrets.
Did you find the place where you were hit?
Generally speaking, yeah, because the tree's still there. And, I couldn't find memories of it, though, which is good. Well, of course, that's 23 some odd years ago.
I know, but it was, as I recall, the circumstances, most of the people in your outfit were wiped out, weren't
that's
they?
Right, yeah, all but six. We were a place called Death Valley. We just kind of caught in an ambush, and that was that.
Are you still in the Marine Corps?
No.
You're out of the reserves?
Yeah. Well, I was got a medical discharge when we got hit, so...
You still have a scar on your back, as I recall.
Yeah, I do, on my butt.
Yeah. On your butt?
Every good Marine gets shot in the butt. Which always opens up the question, which way were you going, right?
Yeah, it's easy to get shot in the butt sometimes, though.
Yeah, well, there's only two high spots when you're on the ground. That's your head and your rear end. So they hit you in the head, you're dead, and they hit in the butt, you're wounded.
I met one of the boys, a Marine, who was with him, and he said, we used to call him Captain Marvel. And, in the Marines, and he was always talking about when he was going to be an actor. Well, this is Lee. I see him as Captain Marvel. Keenan Wynn and Lee Marvin used to practice with their barbells every day at the studio. And they were so funny, the two of them. They were either on motorcycles or, with, as I say, with the barbells, that they decided one day to shoot the scene as it was. And this is one of when I talk to other actors, this is one of the classic scenes in movies now, this scene. And it was just as they really were, you know, working with those barbells.
Hey, listen, Slob, I ordered another set of barbells. You want to go have these with me? Oh, that's great. This is Charlie Strongtree's latest invention. He says it develops the latissimus, you know.
Yeah, we're both a little weak in that department.
Yeah, well, he says 2 weeks of that and we'll be the envy of Muscle Beach.
Will them tomatoes go for us, huh?
Look, I do it for no tomatoes. I do this for myself. You wouldn't believe it. You know, Slob, at one time I was so skinny, I was embarrassed to undress in front of myself.
I see what you mean. But you know, it's one thing, I don't go for those guys on Muscle Beach. Their waist is so thin, there's no room for any food.
Yeah, those idiots. They're way over the top. Who wants to go around walking in a leopard skin all the time, anyway? Those guys can't wear clothes. Hey, I look pretty good in a suit, though, don't I? Don't
you? Yeah, great. Especially that double-breasted brown job. What about me?
Well, your clothes don't do too much for you.
How did you get to be an actor? How did you get started with it? Because that would have been the furthest thing.
Yeah. Well, I was 21 and just out of the service, and there was a stock company starting out in Woodstock, and they needed a tall, loudmouth guy to play a Texan. So I met them at a party, and I was a little, I guess, under the weather or, you know, in the mood. And my cubs, so they said, he's loud enough and tall enough, can he act? And so E.J. Ballantyne, who was my counselor of the area, in essence, he's an old Shakespearean actor. He said, sure, you can. So I went down and read for him, and they hired me. Mm-hmm. They gave me $7 a week and on board.
You know, in your one of your many bios, it says that you were a plumber's assistant, $37 a week.
Yeah, that's right.
Was that true?
I was a ditch digger. I used to dig the septic tank holes. Yeah. You know.
But that you came to repair a leaky faucet.
No, that's just that's a figment of somebody's imagination. That's just true.
After that, though, you did a lot of stock. Mm-hmm. And then television.
And Broadway, yeah.
And in Broadway.
And then I decided to come out here in 1950.
But that's a long apprenticeship.
Yeah? Police officers, your name Henry Ross?
He did a film with us. I think his first large role back in the days when both of us were itinerant performers, working for 20-minute guarantees at some of the major studios. And that's where I first met Lee. And when Dragnet became a reality, and went on to television, Lee went along with us and did a part. It was a, as we did in a great many of our early shows, a three-man piece. In other words, the two police officers and Lee Marvin as the suspect. And at one point, he finally broke and said, all right, I'll tell you. I'll cop out to you. And if you'll buy me a health food dinner, I'll tell you. And then the script had specified prunes, and Lee said before we went into the filming of it, he said, I can't eat prunes. I don't care for them. What could we substitute? Now, so our property man said, why not use Satsuma plums? And he had these large number 24 cans, and he filled this dish up, and Lee was supposed to order an enormous helping, which he did in the scene. And his diction became progressively worse and worse, and that's one thing that he's never known for, and certainly not today, has magnificent diction. And I said, Lee, wait a minute. And we stopped everything. I said, you know, it's gotten to the point where I can't understand you. And he said, well, it's no wonder, and it was really about this bad. And it seems that the property man had neglected to tell any of us that the Satsuma plums were not pitted. And Lee, trooper that he was, kept going in the scene, and these enormous 5-6-page speeches that he had, he never quit. But he stored up those pits like a squirrel does, you know, nuts in the winter.
What brought you here to Hollywood?
Well, originally, you know, I was doing stock and television in New York. And Henry Hathaway, one of Hollywood's better directors, came to New York. He was going to do a Navy picture down in Norfolk, so he had an open interview for sailor types. So I waited 3 days and got an interview with him. Or, you know, I walked in his office. And so we talked for a few minutes, and the next thing I know, I had a job. So I worked for 3 days down in Norfolk, and they kept me out for 3 weeks, and they said, come out to the coast with him.
What was the picture?
The working title was USS Teakettle. Mm-hmm. But now it's called, I think you're in the Navy now, Gary Cooper.
Yeah.
So they stayed on the picture for about 10 weeks, and then I took a look at Hollywood and said, hey.
Yeah.
So I went home for Christmas and then packed up all my stuff and came back.
During the 10 or 12 weeks, did you have just one role, or did you have many in that picture?
Well, I had many. I had anybody that had yes, sir, or no, sir, or aye, aye, sir, that was me. You know, to cover my face with a microphone, or, you know.
Well, when you came to Hollywood, was it with a job in mind, or just to
have... No, I came out with speculation, and then I had a job 3 days later, which was very fortunate. Yeah, again, it was another Hathaway film, Diplomatic Courier. So as I started working right away, I never let up.
Well, were you a good guy, mainly, in those early pictures, or a bad guy, mainly?
A bad guy.
You're fooling with me. Like, I'm strong, I mean, talk. Come on.
Lee and I did this long scene where he ends up choking me in the end. He had this, the timing so perfect. He had it choreographed almost like a dance. And he went from sequence to sequence, had me all over the room, and he hardly ever touched me. If he'd take my arm, I could barely feel it. But even when he had that towel and choked me at the end, it wasn't quite touching my throat. And yet it was so real, and I was so frightened, I blacked out.
I think almost all guys start off as a bad guy.
That's the best way, isn't it?
Yeah, you know, the most colorful roles, yeah. Too. Because, you know, you look at Spencer Tracy and, you know, The Last Mile and Bogart and all his crying things and Cagney. And
then you kind of become a good bad guy.
Yeah, then you
sort of ace into
it. Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Well, in that case, we better keep moving.
Holy God.
About 15 years ago or so, I worked with a very unknown actor in a picture called Bad Dad Black Rock. The actor was Lee Marvin. It was quite obvious then to Spencer Tracy and me and quite a large cast of professionals that this young man had a very great future. You do have to have a break, no matter how talented you are. And we knew that someday the break would come for Lee, and it did in Cat Ballou. And he's on top of the world, and that's where he should be. I worked again with him in The Professionals, and actually in the picture just following that called A Dirty Dozen. And all the promise that he had, that we knew he had at that time, had finally come to full flower.
Did you go to the actor's studio while you were...
No, they wouldn't let me in for some reason.
Did you try?
Well, I auditioned a couple of times, and they said, well, do you want out of the studio? And I said, a job. So...
That wasn't acceptable.
No, it's not acceptable.
What should you have said?
I want God or the earth or to be real or, you know, some of it.
Should have said I want to be loved. Do you have what you call a Marvin system, other than just getting into it and doing it?
Well, I could probably, you know, write a book about it, and I don't know who'd buy it. I mean, only the failures would buy it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, only the failures, I guess.
Maybe the hiking books.
Yeah.
I think acting is a personal desire, and you work on it your own way, whatever individual approach that is.
And I guess you can mature as an actor. As a person, as you mature, you also mature as more as an actor, too, don't you?
Oh, sure, because I mean, look at Bogart. We were just discussing him. I saw on the tube the other night. I saw the Cam Newton, which I was in. I watched him play Captain Queeg in that.
What happened? What's going on?
Doing out there. What the blazes have you been doing?
Sir, you told me to keep right standard rudder.
You idiot!
All engines stop.
And he's about the only guy at that time that could have really played it that well, because he was the symbol of strike, you know. And to have him crack up. Ooh.
Captain, we've steamed over our own tow line.
Who said we steamed over the tow line? Who said that?
We've cut the target adrift.
We did nothing of the kind. Something must have been wrong with the cable. We can hardly be held responsible if we're given faulty cables that break the minute the ship turns a few degrees.
Did you like Captain Queeg?
I liked him. Well, not a lot, but I liked him. He acted strange.
Was it strange he cleaned up the cane?
No, sir.
Was it strange he made the men get haircuts?
No, sir.
Was it strange he was strict about Navy regulations?
No, sir.
Evidently, what you thought stranger is attempts to make good sailors of his crew. That's all.
Have you kept many close friends over the years?
I have close friends, but they're like, you know, 3 or 4 years apart. But I have a lot of strange friends, too, that supplement my time, you know, stuntmen and extras. person. You totally have accurate plans that you eventually end up acting like each other.
We've known each other close to 20 years. We did a very good one. I thought was a very fine TV show on the old Dick Powell Theater called The Losers.
Took a fire and fertilizer. Got cleaned out by a Sunday school teacher from Vegas.
You cleaned, huh?
To the bone. But with this stake, we can start again, David, and I've got plans, and I don't mean poker.
What?
Emeralds. A river full of them.
No, thank you.
South America, David. Beautiful, soft-eyed maidens waiting in the moonlight.
Now, I got an option on 600 acres up near Dummies. I think I'll pick up on it. But I get the money that's owed me.
60-40.
That's a deal.
Yeah.
Psychiatrist? That sounds psychiatrically oriented slightly.
No. Yeah, I've been to a psychiatrist, sure. I've done a lot of work, though, you know, with those type of roles.
You must have your own identity. You couldn't take on someone else's, I don't think.
No, I agree with that. I think that I've, you know, well, I'm 44 now, so let's say that by the time I was about 40, I fairly well figured out who I was. So now it's just all a breeze, in a sense. Mm. You know, it's delightful now to live. As before, it was always, why do I do these things? And, you know, so now you simply accept them. I mean, you don't change, you just accept them.
No, but you accept them and you understand them.
Yeah, because that inner conflict, like Carl Menninger says, you know, man against himself.
Right. And you know what's destructive for you.
Yeah.
And I think also you know your limitations.
Very much so, and I have a lot of them.
Well, most of us do, I suspect. Yeah. But to know them is the real key.
Well, to know them is just to be free.
That's right. Freedom is
ultimate.
That's the ultimate. Would you tell you, if you had a son, or you do have a son who's getting older, what kind of thing would you tell him about freedom, about living his life?
I think just about that, Joe, that everything in life is immaterial, really, except for the fact of eating or sleeping. But the greatest material thing in life is your own personal freedom. And if you're going to maintain that, then everything is open to you. And of course, freedom requires one other attribute, and that's honesty.
Mm-hmm.
You know, self-honesty and honesty to your compatriots. That's about as far as I go with any conversation.
That's far enough, I would think. When you got the Oscar, you said, for Cat Blue, you said that it was like getting an electric, sitting in the electric chair.
Like going to the
electric chair. Like going to the electric. Did you really feel that way?
Oh, yeah, it was awful.
Why?
Well, you know, one second you say, I'm obviously the guy. I mean, nobody's as good as me.
Mm-hmm.
And the next second you say, yeah, but those guys, you know, so nice. The Olympian is pretty good. Say, yeah, he is. Outside, he's good too. It's running. Yeah, he's good. And, you know, you're in and out of focus so rapidly. By the time they say the name, it's just like, you know, they're giving you the 20,000 volts.
I think the one thing that I will remember most of all about Lee is his classic Academy Award acceptance. When he said, part of this belongs to some horse out in the valley. I think that'll live for many years.
Was there a point along your performance of the role when you felt that this might be it, this might be the big one?
No, I don't think an actor feels that. Really, you always hope, but you know, you've done so many of them that you cease to hope. So you just simply do it. And if it works out, strong. And it worked out.
Although for a first-time nomination and then winning, it's a pretty good track.
Well, I haven't looked at the odds, and it feels great, I'll tell you that.
And I must say that having done a little comedy, I thought Lee Marvin's performance was one of the finest comedy performances I've seen in years and years, and a well-deserved award.
Well, usually, according to the legend, it's supposed to be a kind of a curse, but it doesn't seem to have done that to you. It doesn't seem to have slowed your career down.
No, if anything, it's really sped it up. Yeah, it's been very good for me. I can't knock it, because it is my industry's congressional medal, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm part of that industry, so it may take the time to figure out that I'm the guy that I say, well, gee whiz, I must be making some points with him.
You know, one of the roles that you've liked in terms of what they've said and your own performances, if somebody came and said, I want to do a biography of
Lee Marvin from Only Films, what would you send him to see? What do you think, or what do you particularly prefer?
Well, I preferred all of them at the time, so that's the problem. But of course, as I say, years went by.
Yeah.
I like doing Fishaline, not doing the role,
but like Cat Blue.
Yeah, in Cat Blue. Because here was a man that was living in an alcoholic world with comedy, though, so mm-hmm. more people would see it and enjoy it, but still get the message of the fact that, you know, you gotta grow up someday.
Mm-hmm.
You see a man with his eyes set, his head on a bias like, his teeth acted like a mule. Well, you know, he just soon hang here because our fence posts say great day in the morning. Well, he a gunfighter. Proud and feared of nothing.
I'll take care of you.
Is it you?
The idea for Kid Chalene obviously was a very extravagant kind of notion. It was one step away from fall down comedy.
I would have been a little more reluctant to take chances, because when you're on the top of a mountain and you look over into the canyon, there's a long way to drop. There's a lot to lose. And Lee, at the time he had the part, was known throughout the profession as a very competent, skillful, trained actor. And despite that fact, he had less to lose than an actor who might have already achieved the prominence that he has today. So one of the reasons I think he got the award was because of his boldness and his courage in daring to go out that far. He was being asked to play right on the edge of insanity, and if it had not worked, and nobody knew whether it would or it wouldn't, if it had not worked, then he could have looked like a fool.
How about some of the earlier pictures? Were there any of those that you particularly fond of?
Point Blank was a small picture. Scope and concept, even though well made.
Mm-hmm.
The reason I did Point Blank was to show that you can do a violent film without ever doing it yourself. Because in that film, all the people get killed, but I don't kill anybody in it.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't think I do.
I worked with Lee on two pictures. The Killers, extremely violent. Point Blank, more violent. Lee has the character on the screen, to me, that no matter what he's playing, a good guy, a really bad guy, as he was in The Killers, a real villain, of being liked by every, you like him, maybe because he's such a good villain. And I think it's because, of course he's unique, and he has a great face. There's no denying that great shock of hair, which is fantastic, and that he's gone with it. He's never fought his looks. He's used consciously or unconsciously every asset. Even if you have a fight with him on the set, not a fight, but if you get in a strange thing about you know, how a scene should be done, and everybody gets uptight if you're unsure about a scene or if it's not coming off the way you want it to. And even if you like Lee Marvin.
Is it easier to play a good guy than a bad guy? Or the bad guy, it seems.
No, bad guy is easier because he offends you personally, so you can just act that out.
But you had said once it's a lot easier to kiss a broad than knock her ears off, I think.
Yeah.